Okay, so I'm going to go over the different stages of registering and managing Crossref DOIs. So the obvious first step is to join Crossref. I think you've already done. Next, you'll need to publish your content, deposit DOIs, query for DOIs, link them in your references, and maintain them. So the order I'm presenting these steps in isn't necessarily the order you need to do things in, and don't view it as a recommended workflow. You need to do whatever works best for your organization. It's just easier for me to break it out into steps when I'm explaining it. So Carol already went over this a bit, but I just wanted to mention some things about the actual DOI. So when you first join, you are assigned a prefix. It's really important to note that the DOI prefix identifies who initially created the DOI. It doesn't identify who is currently maintaining the DOI. That could be anyone. I know we occasionally come across publishers who acquire a title from another publisher and want to assign their own DOIs to that title because they're really tied to their prefix. But we ask that when titles move from publisher to publisher, that the originally assigned DOIs are maintained, and that you not consider prefixes for branding or identifying you as the publisher. So regarding the suffix, we just ask, I think the most important thing to remember is that they need to be unique, obviously, and we have some examples here of creating a prefix. The most important thing to remember is to keep it simple. And the other important thing that I want to note is that we do limit the characters allowed in a DOI suffix. Basically, you know, alphanumeric and a few kind of punctuation things. We used to allow more characters, and the actual DOI standards allows all kinds of stuff, but we've noticed that special characters and angled brackets, etc., cause a lot of problems with links. So we've blocked them, and it's made everyone's life a lot easier. Okay, so the next step after you have your DOI prefix and you've decided on your suffix pattern is to publish your item online. That's your journal article, book, report. All of those things will need a DOI response page, which is the page the DOI resolves to. Usually this is the same as whatever your article landing page is. And we require that your response page includes bibliographic information about the item so that it can be identified as what you think it should be, a means to access full text, and the DOI itself. And I'm just a little note to reinforce the newish display guidelines. I should also note that DOIs are required on the response page. They're recommended on other pages. Wherever a persistent link is needed in your table of contents, abstracts, citation downloads, metadata feeds, they're not just for reference linking. Here is an example of a DOI on a response page. It's pretty simple. You know, it's a typical journal page, just has the DOI added. So the next steps are the most complex and involve sending and receiving data from Crossref. The first thing you do is you deposit DOIs and metadata with us, which enables inbound linking, meaning you and others are able to use DOIs to link to your content. You also look up DOIs for other publishers and include them in your references and as outbound links. I'm going to cover depositing first, but querying and outbound linking can happen at whatever point in your workflow makes sense to you. So, so you send us in a deposit, and this is kind of, you probably can't read this, but this is just a really simple journal deposit. It contains basic examples like journal title and ISSN. And also some important article information, like the article title, contributor names. We ask that you send in all of the authors, this particular example, which I just made up, only has one person name. I probably should have included more. And of course, one of the very important pieces of metadata is the DOI and the URL. So we call the process of sending metadata to the Crossref system depositing. Sometimes we use the term deposit and register interchangeably, but they're slightly different. When a publisher deposits a DOI, the metadata is added to the Crossref database, making the DOI retrievable. The DOI is also registered with the handle resolver, meaning the DOI and URL only are registered with handle. No citation metadata is recorded by the handle resolver. That all stays with us. And so this is an important point. Immediately after your submission is processed, the system sends you a submission log, which needs to be reviewed at some point. That contains all of the information about whether your deposit was processed, or whether the DOIs were registered, whether you ran into any problems or created any conflicts. A lot of times when a publisher first starts depositing with us, they think that they send us their deposit, they get a success message, that means everything's great. That just means that our system has actually accepted your deposit and has started processing it. It doesn't mean that the DOIs are registered. So after we... Okay, so this is just an example of the submission log. It's in XML, so it can be processed programmatically. You can also retrieve the logs by polling. There's more information on that in our help documentation. So each log has a summary at the bottom. And this is just a little pull out of that. It records the success and failures in your deposit. Hopefully they'll all be successful. If there are any warnings or failures, they need to be reviewed. If the success count matches the record count, which means how many DOIs were submitted, then you can just go about your day. So once the DOI has been registered, it's resolvable and queryable, meaning it can be used for linking and can be retrieved from our system by end users, Crossref metadata subscribers, library link resolvers, and of course other members. You can see there's someone with a sad face. That's someone who's trying to use a DOI that was published but not registered successfully. So I'm just going to go over some of the interfaces we have for depositing. So our submission methods vary from very robust, complicated systems to one guy cutting and pasting stuff from Word into our web deposit form. Most deposits are made by machine interfaces. Data is sent to us via HTTP POST. We do have a simple Java-based tool that you can use for uploads. It's available in our help documentation, but most publishers prefer to create their own tools. We don't accept FTP deposits. We get that question occasionally. And our system also has a very simple public interface at doi.crossref.org that you can use to just manually upload files that you've created. And we also have the web deposit form that generates the XML for you. Anna is going to talk about that a little later, so I won't go into that. We have some interfaces for querying as well. So after you've deposited your DOIs, you need to query Crossref to retrieve DOI matches for outbound linking. Which means you need to search our database for DOI matches for your journal articles. Outbound linking is required for recent journal articles, but we encourage publishers to link references for back issues and other content types as well, since it strengthens the linking network for everyone. So we have some query interfaces as well. If you're able, we suggest that you query using XML. You can upload bulk XML queries, pull the system using XML queries, or do open URL queries. And I have a link throughout my presentation. I have links to the help topics on what I'm talking about with more details. We also have a few public interfaces. Again, I won't go into those in detail. So after you've finished querying, you need to include your DOIs in the reference list on your website. They can be represented in a few different ways. Here's an example. The article links are DOI links. Here's another example with the full http://dx.doi.org/DOI URL. So now we're going to move on to maintaining DOIs and metadata. So for the most part, if the metadata you send us is thorough and accurate, DOIs don't need to be touched. There are some circumstances that require regular attention. Mainly that's URL updates. So this is the most frequent change for obvious reasons. If you make changes to your site or acquire DOIs from another publisher, DOIs can be updated easily. You either redeposit all your metadata with the new URLs, and the metadata in our system will be overwritten, including the URL. You can also just email us a tab-separated list of DOIs and their new URLs. We can process those fairly quickly. If you're sending us like millions of DOIs, you might want to give us a heads up and ask how long it's going to take, because that can sometimes take several days or weeks, depending on how many DOIs need to be updated. If you discover errors in your metadata or otherwise need to make an update, it's important to redeposit your metadata with the changes and include all of the metadata in your submission, just not the updates. Any metadata that's already in the system will be completely overwritten. So if you deposit your DOIs with an online publication date before the item's been published in print, you need to update the metadata with the print date, but also include the online date, because we won't, if you don't include it in the redeposit, it'll be wiped out. There is no charge for updating your DOIs. We encourage you to update them as often as you need to. So now I'm going to get into reports. Here's a fairly exhaustive list, and I'm going to go into each one with excruciating detail. Not really. So some of these apply to all members. Others are created on an as-needed basis. I'm going to go through some of the reports that deal directly with maintaining your DOIs and metadata. So this is probably the most popular report, the resolution report. If it goes out late, then we get people asking for it. So people find it very useful. It's by default, we send it out to the business contact we have on file. So if you're a technical person and you've never seen it, you might want to contact us and ask us to add you to the distribution list. The resolution report is comprised of statistics we extract from DOI resolution logs, and contains data about how many times your DOIs have been clicked and your overall resolution failure rate. That's successes versus failures. So you probably can't see that, but this lists how many resolutions you have per month, how many resolution attempts, that means how many times someone tried to resolve one of your DOIs, how many times those attempts failed, and how many times they were successful. It also lists your top 10 DOIs and how many times they've been resolved. Yeah, so this is the most important part. It's at the top of the report. The report lists your overall failure weight as well as the overall failure percentage for all members. So this failure rate for this report is 18%, which is actually pretty bad. Usually the failure rate is around 2%, and a lot of that's just like crawlers or someone mistyping a DOI. So it's good to pay attention to your report, but If your failure rate's around 2%, you can probably relax and assume you're doing everything you're supposed to be doing. There's a CSV file that's attached to your report that lists all of the failed DOI resolution attempts. So, like I said, some of these are just, I don't want to say garbage, but, you know, just, you know, people adding a period onto the end of the DOI or like cutting and pasting the wrong thing. But if you have a high failure rate, like if you have someone trying to resolve the same DOI 50 times, you might want to investigate and see whether, A, if that's a legitimate DOI. If it's not, B, if it's not a legitimate DOI, if you can find it anywhere and see if someone's, you know, has your DOI misrepresented. Often those, you're able to fix that, like if it's on Wikipedia or something, you can just contact whoever's hosting the site with the bad DOI and they're usually happy to fix it. So another report is the depositor report. It lists all DOIs deposited for journals, books, and conference proceedings. So for each title, you can get a list of the DOIs and the current owning prefix. We also have conflict reports. We send these out, an alert about conflicts monthly, to the technical context if you have conflicts to resolve. A conflict happens when you deposit two or more DOIs with the same metadata. We only allow you to assign one DOI per item, so you shouldn't be assigning multiple DOIs to the same item. But there are cases in which you might need to do that, like if you're assigning errata or something that doesn't have an author and they're all on the same page, so the metadata you deposit isn't distinct. So we don't actually block those deposits, but so instead we just flag them and send you, it's flagged in your submission log, but you also get this report. Just look at the detail. Well, you can't really look at it, but like if you click on a title, one of your journal titles in the conflict report, you'll get a detail about which items are actually in conflict and why. So this, the next report is kind of important. It's a DOI error report. They're compiled from complaints about unresolving DOIs submitted to us by end users. So if an end user tries to resolve a DOI that hasn't been registered, they see this form, which they can submit to us with comments and their email address. And then if the DOI they've submitted to us is ever registered, we send them an alert saying, oh, the DOI you complained about is ready. So, and any comments in these fields are passed on to publishers. But we also pass on, even if a user doesn't comment or leave their email, we send you a note saying, hey, someone told us this DOI isn't registered. So if you never get these, that's good. And so the most common reason you get one of these is that you published a DOI but didn't deposit it. Or it's possible you published a DOI but it doesn't match the DOI you deposited. Someone made a mistake when they were uploading the DOI. Or it could just be user error, which if it's user error, there's usually nothing you can do about that. So the last report I'm going to mention is the Schematron report. Schematron's a validation language, and we use it to identify messy metadata. We really need to be flexible and accommodate variances in data, so our deposit schema can't keep all of the questionable data out without blocking the good data as well. So we do it this post-deposit metadata review and pick out items we think might need more attention. These are emailed out weekly. We send out about 45 reports a week, which is like 1 or 2% of the membership. So if you don't get one, great, but if you do, that means there's probably a problem and you need to pay attention to it. So I'll just finish up by just directing you to some help resources. We have fairly comprehensive help documentation. We have support staff, and we have, so you can either email support at crossref.org or go to support.crossref.org, and we've got a whole ticketing system. We also have occasional webinars. we have an announcements forum. It's not really a forum, it's more of just announcements, but this is where we announce any system outages or new tools. Or sometimes, like, if we've added new documentation for something that needs attention. So it's really important that someone from your organization subscribes to that announcements forum. You can either do it using a RSS feed or subscribe by email. And we also have a PressRef quarterly newsletter. Usually if there's any big change, we'll announce it there as well. And that's about it.